We have covered cerebral palsy, DDH, development dysplastic, HIFs, Perthes, and now another chapter, which is post-polio deformity and residual paralysis. And this was a too long, like a book. So I divided this lecture in two parts so that the trainees and junior consultant can understand post-polio deformity, though it is less common nowadays as compared to the cerebral palsy. But mostly the reconstructive surgery relates with the cerebral palsy surgery as well. So my today's lecture is the post-polio residual paralysis, pathophysiology and principle. I have two experts and three experts with me. Professor Faridullah Zimri from Islamabad. Oh. Professor Zamir Sumro from Ladkana, Shahid Mohtarma Benazir Bhutto University Orthopedic Department. And both are most popular in this reconstructive surgeries in cerebral palsy, poliomyelitis, and especially in these rough techniques. Professor Imtiaz Hashmi from Ziyadi University. If you see this picture, it shows the all aspects of the poliomyelitis deformity. Monkey gait, supported flexion contracture of the hip, then the knee problems and the foot problems. So we need to correct this deformity at a proper time. So before embarking on reconstructive surgery, the surgeon and his trainees must understand and also should have a knowledge about the pathological process, how these deformities are produced, and the patho-anatomy of deformity itself. Is it a simple deformity, a complex deformity? That can be easily done with the clinical, proper clinical assessment, and then the principles of reconstructive surgery. If these things are very understanding and known by the surgeon, then it is easy job for him to get reconstruction without any mistake. My second lecture will be on 9th April on Friday, next Friday, where I will cover the regional deformities in the poliomyelitis, how these deformities are produced, principles of management of these deformities, and then we will also do the case discussion. I can say that poliomyelitis is an infectious disease which leads to a lower motor paralysis, and it manifests with the four types. Asymptomatic infection, which vanishes very soon, just a rhinorrhea and the flu-like symptoms. Then abortive poliomyelitis, acute symptom, and then get abolished. Then non-paralytic poliomyelitis, a minor poliomyelitis may occur, and then the paralytic poliomyelitis. We are mostly concerned, orthopedic surgeons are mostly concerned with the paralytic poliomyelitis, and 30% of these children with the paralytic disease completely recover, and 30% has a mild symptom, which we call non-paralytic poliomyelitis. But 30% other group is that who has a permanent paralysis of moderate degree to a severe degree. From acute symptomatic poliomyelitis, 10% of patients may die in acute phase because of difficulty in swallowing and because of the breathing problems. So we are mostly concerned with the paralytic poliomyelitis, and we will continue to discuss on the how this is produced and which areas are getting affected. So disease course is mostly in three phases. One is acute illness, which may last from 10 to 15 days, and the paralysis occur in this phase group. And then there is a recovery phase, we call it convalescent phase, where a degree of spontaneous recovery occurs in the muscle, and I will explain in the next slides why incomplete paralysis and the variant degree of patterns is being held in the poliomyelitis. And if we can prevent the deformities, development of deformity in this phase, the patient has no significant deformity. But the residual paralysis, then it is chronic paralysis, which remains a lifelong, and the final phase of residual paralysis occurs. The regarding distribution of residual paralysis, 92% patient develops in the lower limb, only 4% in the lower limb and the trunk, and upper limb and the lower limb combined in 1%, bilateral legs in 6%, 0.6%, and the trunk, upper limb and lower limb in 2%. So worst deformity is very less, but the simple and the common deformities or common paralysis occurs in the lower limb, and we are really most concerned about this posture, how these children move, and how they earn their money. So paralysis in the poliomyelitis is permanent. It is asymmetrical and flaccid mostly with normal sensation. So this asymmetry and incompleteness occur in the same limb or in the contralateral limb. Both limbs are not equal in the paralysis, and it's also differentiate from the lower motor neuron of other diseases and the upper motor neuron. Asymmetry and incompleteness, the classical finding of poliomyelitis, these two things differentiate from other poliomyelitis diseases and upper limb. If you see on this five differential diagnosis, the poliomyelitis is asymmetrical, lower motor and tribe, no sensory loss, may improve with time and may become an static in time. But if you see the myopathy, usually it is symmetrical on both sides, same type of paralysis. It is again a lower motor disease, no sensory loss. But this myopathy deteriorates in time is and have a specific shoulder girdle paralysis, lower girdle paralysis, both leg paralysis, but have a specific pattern. There is no incompleteness or asymmetrical paralysis in myopathy and spina bifida. Again, the spina bifida have lower motor neuron disease. Usually it is symmetrical. Motor loss deteriorates with the growth. As the growth increases, there is a tension on the nerves and it produces deterioration. As compared to the poliomyelitis, this deterioration much worse. Then if you take a neuropathy, again it is symmetrical, it is bilateral, it may have a sensory loss as well and the motor loss. But here the sensory loss is glow and stalking pattern, and this may improve with the treatment, with the time. And this is the characteristic feature would differentiate it from poliomyelitis. While cerebral palsy is upper motor neuron paralysis, it has a specific pattern as well. And here a special element is spasticity and hyperreflexia. It is symmetrical, but there is no sensory loss. So asymmetry and incompleteness is the characteristic feature of poliomyelitis, which differentiate from other three lower motor neuron diseases when upper motor neuron disease. The question arises, why this asymmetrically and incomplete paralysis in poliomyelitis? If you see on this neuron system, it is explained that some muscle have a short columns in the spinal cord and some muscle has a long column. So when there is a disease, they destroy the neurons and the recovery also takes place. The short muscles have a complete paralysis because of the short column. So therefore, when there is a short column destruction, so complete paralysis occur. When there is a long column, the incomplete paralysis in recovery occur. Therefore, the most important muscle with the short columns are tibialis anterior, quadriceps femoris, deltoid, and aponeus pollicis. And you have seen the important important characteristic deformity and paralysis do occur in majority of cases with the tibialis anterior, quadriceps femoris, and the deltoid. And this is explained by the size of the column in the spinal cord. Then deformity may become progressive. How this become progressive? It is explained from this chart. There is usually balance between the muscle. It can be produced because of the deformity in the spasm. If we do not take care on these two issues with the braces and the posture, this may lead to the development of contractures and the deformities. But as the child grows, there is an oppositional growth and then there is a longitudinal growth and muscles are weak. These muscles become flaccid because of the reduced blood mass is smaller. They are flaccid, they are less active. Therefore, there is a decreased blood supply to this, and this decreases the tension or stress on the bone, and therefore the bone remains shorter, and limb, if there is a unilateral, remains shorter, which we call LLD. So when there is a flaccidity, there is loss of function as well. So because of this flaccidity, loss of action, reduced stress on the bone, it progressive shortening and it progressive continuous progressive deformity. Then there another element is gravity in the posture. This posture and gravity in recovery phase, if it's not maintained properly, this will develop a contractures and the contractures and the bone deformities both. When the contracture becomes static, the bone grows. When the bone grows, they produce more deformities and contracture in the bone as well as in the joints. So here we explain by the four elements, how do muscle spasm occurs and how do it produce a contracture. So there is a muscle spasm and there is a protective response. When there is a protective response to keep the joint immobilized by nature, it produces a contracture of temporary nature. But if we do not take care of this temporary contracture, it may lead to a permanent contracture. Then there is a gravity and posture. And you have seen the patient usually lie in the rest position. The rest position is the abduction, flexion of the hip joint and the knee joints. Because of this gravity and posture, patient develops a contracture from the hip to the knee and to the foot as well, and which is a very important factor. Then there is a muscle imbalance and the functional loss. And because of this asymmetry and functional paralysis, there is a hamstring tight, and the quadriceps are weak. They develop then the tendoacles is tight. Then it produces a equinus contracture, and then depends on the peronei and the tibialis muscles. If these are more stronger, the foot goes out on that side. Then the growth attenuation, we have already explained, because of the small mass, because of less of stimulation to the bones, there is lack of diminished oppositional and longitudinal growth, and it produces a limb length inequality. The muscle wasting is there, muscles are weak. Therefore, the reflexes also are diminished. As in cerebral palsy, reflex is hyperreflexive. But here, you may not find the reflexes, and that reflex is not because of the neuron, particularly because of the wasting of muscle and the weakness. So here is one of the causes, showing the cause of the progressive deformity. As the child grows, the bone grows more, but there are static muscles which are weak, they produce more contracture. Here is one of the example of the iliotibial bend. This iliotibial bend starts from the iliac crest through the fascia lata. It goes to the knee joint Gerdes tubercle, and further the postural paralysis, it produces a deformity of flexion contracture at the hip joint. And when the tightness is more and hamstring are more tighter, they produce a flexion deformity at the knee joint. But this is the postural deformity because of the contracture in tibialis iliotibial bend. And if it persists, it may produce a valgus deformity. And this valgus deformity in the posture in combination can also produce a deformity at the ankle joint in the foot. Therefore, these contractures, static contractures because of the overgrowth of the bone or normal growth of the bone, continue to produce a contracture from recovery phase to the residual paralysis. Then most common muscle paralysis are in the tibialis anterior. Tibialis anterior has very short column, and total damage occur when there is a poliomyelitis. The next is the quadriceps femoris, which is very commonly involved, and it produces a handy gait. And in upper limbs, the mostly the deltoid and opponents are getting, because of the short column of representation in the spinal cord, these are the muscles which are commonly involved, severely involved, and the up in upper limbs. The most common deformities in residual paralysis due to the improper treatment in the columnar joints occur a flexion, abduction, and external rotation deformity because of tight tibialis and iliotibial tect. And iliotibial tect also act on the knee joint. It produces a flexion. And when there is a contracture of the hamstring and weak quadriceps, it may produce triple deformity, that is at the knee joint, which is comprises of the flexion of knee deformity. There may be a subluxation of the knee joint and external rotation of the leg because it acts on the Gerdes tubercle and it produces an external. So this is triple deformity, that is a flexion, posterior subluxation, and tibial torsion in the tibia because of the, again, hamstring and the iliotibial tract contracture. Then there is a different type of foot deformities which can occur, like an equinus, cavo varus, calcaneo valgus, and typical club foot deformity. These all four patterns, most common is the equinus, then is the equinovarus, then cavo varus, and the pilonovalgus deformity. These are the deformities which are mostly common occur in the lower limbs, while in upper limb, there is the shoulder muscle paralysis and the phalanger paralysis, which may produce from flaility of the shoulder to the incomplete paralysis. So here is the certain worse deformity, a worse paralysis which leads to further deformity occurs. One example is the genu recurvatum. And the in long life deformity, there is a bony problems occurring because of this recurvatum and the posture and also in the foot. So these are the deformities worse to treat. We have to prevent the progressive deformity in this child by the bracing. This is the hand knee gait. Usually it is because of the paralysis of the quadriceps muscle and the equinus deformity here. The third contracture which is worst is the paralysis of gluteal maximus, and it produces a gluteal lurch. It is very difficult to treat these children with the recurvatum deformity and the gluteal lurch. And the fourth deformity is the calcaneus deformity, where there is the relaxity of the Achilles tendon, vertebralis anterior, and the other muscles are stronger, so produce a calcaneus deformity. So these are the worst deformity occur in terms of the treatments. So then if long lasting or most deformity occurs a long duration, there may be a genu valgus deformity. It may produce a gluteal rush, or in the long standing, instead of the valgus flexion deformity, it can produce a recurvatum deformity because of the paralysis of the quadriceps femoris and give way by the hamstrings. Hamstring, if they are weak, quadriceps is weak, it may produce a deformity which we call genu recurvatum. But if continues this contracture continues in the flexion deformity because of iliotibial tract or the contracture of the gastrocnemius, this may produce a subluxation at the knee joint, and it may produce a dislocated pattern at the ankle joint and the metatarsal joints. Then a spinal deformity may also occur. This spinal deformity occur usually due to weak abdominals and the spinal muscle both. Initially, the curve, which is scoliosis may occur or kyphosis may occur. Kyphoscoliosis, you can see here, this curve may be initially a compensatory and paralytic compensatory and postural, which can be corrected by the braces. But if this curve continues with the time, it become a static curvature, and this usually endangers the compromised lungs. It may compromise the heart function as well. So it produces a severe deformity usually when the all four limbs are involved and there is a spinal muscle involvement and the abdominal muscle involvement. It produces a very severe deformity which may range from the scoliosis to kyphoscoliosis with contracture of the hip joint and the knee joint, and usually these children become bound with the wheelchair. Then if poliomyelitis is not properly treated in the calvarinus phase, which do occur in our setup, particularly in the far-flung areas of the villages, they may produce a quadriplegic pattern. It may produce a severe paralysis, which you have already seen with the contractures at the hip joint, knee joint subluxation, shoulder, or it may produce a dragging flail lower limbs, and the strong upper limbs may produce monkey gait. This is again a crawling type of gait with the flexion contractures of the hip and knee joints and weakness of the spinal. Here is the double weakness and the recurvatum deformity at the knee joints and severe contracture at the hip joints, and it may have a poliomyelitis. Then the crouch gait, where there is a dorsiflexion of ankles and 90-90 contracture at the hip joint. These are the deformities can occur if poliomyelitis not treated with the bracing and the positional advice during the convalescent phase. So now we are going to treatment options, how we can prevent the deformities and how we can assist to get more residual paralysis to recover back. The treatment in the two phases, acute phase and recovery phase, is mostly orthotics and the physiotherapy to build up, to keep the muscle stronger. And this is usually called a preventive orthopedic care. Here, the physiotherapist, rehabilitation therapist, and the orthopedic surgeon have a combination of treatment along with the pediatrician to assist in recovery of the paralyzed muscles by certain methods we will discuss, remedial exercises, and prevention of deformities by orthotics. When there is a residual paralysis, mostly treatment is surgical reconstruction to restore the balance and provide an independence to the patient in the community. And we will mostly further discuss today on the this bracing system, orthotics, primary orthopedic care, preventive orthopedic care, and the principles of the reconstructive surgeries. And in preventive orthopedic care, the emphasis must be given to slowly progressive non-fatiguing exercise to avoid the overuse weakness. The fatigue, if you do fatiguing exercise, the child will not cooperate with you. So we have to give a slow exercise pattern and pacing of activity in between exercises and the movement of the patient, the rest period to avoid muscle overuse again, and also the energy conservation and weight loss programs we will advise. That these emphasis must be given, and if he is developing a contracture or to prevent the contracture, we can give them orthosis and manage the generalized fatigue as well. So preventive orthopedic objective is to splint, to relieve the pain and spasm by the splint, and posturing, proper posturing to prevent the deformities from the in the acute and recovery phase. Then there is a positional postures which must be advised to the patient to prevent the postural contractures by placing a pillow and the sandbags under the knee joints, and also the plaster splint sometime we give. Here, postural advices for enduring acute and recovery phases to keep hip joint and 5 degree flexion in neutral rotation. If there is a more than this degree, 15, 25 degrees, then this patient can develop a contracture at the hip joint, at the knee joint, and the rotational contracture at the leg. The knee again should be when placed in the 5 degree, not more than the 5 degree flexion, and foot must also be supported in the plantigrade position. If foot will not support, it will develop either a equinovarus deformity or a calcaneovalgus deformity. So we have to prevent these contractures by positioning and postures. And these are again the orthotic and the exercises pattern, how to do and how to avoid the further damage by improper exercises. So there is an efficient physiotherapist with proper postures, proper advices, and the release of contracture with the exercises. And sometimes we also give in during the recovery phase, the hydrotherapy, which is very popular in cerebral palsy patient, and the muscle buildup exercises. Sometime you have to give the electrical stimulation to muscle to keep revived their motor neuron in the spinal cord. Here some figures shows the what should be the method of the exercises. If you will do exercise method with this just pressing the knee joint, it may not release the hip contracture, producing a lordosis here. Therefore, when someone is doing the exercises, he must do in Thomas test position and not push the knee joint, but to relieve the contracture of the hip from here. And then progressively, this is again an example to prevent the subluxation of knee joint. If you pull from the foot, and it will produce a subluxation at the knee joint. So prevention is the upper tibia has to be pushed in the neutral, in the normal position, and knee has to push back in the knee position. Similar is for the foot deformity in equinus contracture. You do correct method. If you do forefoot dorsiflexion, it will produce a recurvatum deformity. But you have to hold the cordyceps heel as well and the forefoot. The whole of foot is managed to have a dorsiflexion. And similar example is the deformity varus correction, in the way one thing has to be stabilized and other has to be mobilized. Then during this phase of recovery, we also use sometimes the orthosis. The orthosis is mostly if dorsiflexors are weak and plantar flexors, both our inverters are weak, we give an AFO. And AFO is the ankle foot orthosis, but there is no involvement of the no stabilizing at the knee joint. But when there is a quadriceps weakness, you must give a longer type of the brace, which we call is a KFO, KFO knee, ankle, foot orthosis. To prevent the contractures and keep the leg straight, we use the KFO. But when there is a weak quadriceps and the weak flexors, a quad glutei at the hip joint, we use above knee calipers like these. And KFO can also be used when the quadriceps paralysis is below 2 and glutei also there is a paralysis. So here is the flexion deformity at the knee joint. The caliper usually should have a tight anterior brace padded brace and loose posterior brace. If there is a recurvatum deformity, then there is an anterior loose strap, but posterior strap has to be tight to keep the leg in neutral position. But if there is a valgus deformity, the strap on the medial side is loose, on the opposite side is the tight, so that it can push the valgus in the neutral position. And this is KFO, where it is KFO, this and the photoanalysis as well in the two views. But when there is a hip HKOF, then there is a pelvic belt. This pelvic belt and mobile joint. Here the mobile joint is help patient to maintain the normal posture, to avoid the abductor and the gluteal lurch and the weakness in the joint, to avoid the recurvatum deformity in the foot as well. So when there is a combination of contractures, other paralysis, you can use a hip KAFO or a caliper like this with the joints at the knee and joints at the hip joints. So these are the certain foot drop splints and the hand drop splints, which are the fixed splint, the dynamic splint for the wrist drop. And here is the T strap, and the foot is placed in the neutral position. Sometimes the people use a string, a dynamic string, a rubber string to keep the plantigrade foot. So these are the straps and deformities for the foot, AFO type or with the caliper stripes. So weaning of orthotic is also important. It should be gradual weaning from the full appliance. If the child can bear a shorter is appliances or the braces, then this is the weaning of the above knee or hip element has to be removed. And as shorter element is managed by the patient, you can change from the longer to smaller, from hip KFO to the hip KFO, from KFO to AFO, and with intensive physiotherapy. So weaning is also important, and timing of weaning is very important. So now I'm going to the general principles of management in the residual paralysis. Before that, we discussed the recovery phase and acute phase, and what are the treatment methods in the residual paralysis, which is usually a permanent paralysis. It may develop an static contracture from lower grade to severe grade to subluxations of the knee joint, mostly in shoulder dislocation. In this, non-operative treatment has role for maintaining the correction which you have achieved and strengthening the unaffected muscle and stretching of the shorting muscles by creating a balance, little bit balance, and the range of motion exercise during this period. And we also use appropriate orthotics or splints or the caliper this phase as well. The mainstay of treatment in the residual paralysis depends on the age and the contractures. So mostly in the early age children's, in the teenage and the young children's, we do the soft tissue releases instead of the bone surgeries. To restore balance, mostly we do the tendon transfers. And in some cases, particularly upper limb, we do the muscle transposition as well. And then leg length inequality by the footwear. And if it is more than 10 or 12 year age, we also do elisirof lengthening. In the next few slides, I will discuss these aspects of surgery, which we call reconstructive surgery in the polio paralysis and deformities. Objective of these deformities and aims of this surgical reconstruction is to return the patient to the home as normal as you can. And patient should be accepted in the community as the community are the normal ambulatory patients. So here, most important factors in decision making for reconstructive surgery are the age of the patient. In very small children, you cannot do the tendon transfer in less than 5 years, but you have to give the splints and orthotics. And when the child are mature or adults, then you can do the bone surgeries while in the recurvatum, as you do the recurvatum femoral osteotomy. So then you also should know the functional assessment of the limb and spine as well. So what are the functional loss and why this functional loss occur? We will discuss in the next slide. Okay, what are the functional loss and how can we assess this? Then socioeconomic background of the patient, because it may usually economical problems are there. The patient needs to be supported by the certain philanthropists, and then the radiological assessment as well to know whether joint alignment is normal or he is developing a subluxation or dislocation is there, mostly in the hip and the knee joints, particularly in the shoulder joints. So these are the functional assessment parameters. So first parameter is very important, is the muscle charting to know the power of the grades. Mostly in the examination, you forget to see the spine and abdominal muscle evaluation. Along with the lower limb and upper limb muscle power assessment, you also need to have the assessment of the paraspinal muscles and the abdominal muscles, because in the gluteal paralysis, you need to be transposition of the muscle, maybe rectus, maybe abdominal obliques, or sometimes the flexor of the hip joint to restore the power of the glutei. Then extent of contracture, whether it's contracture over 15 degree in the knee joint, usually you need a bone surgery. But deformity is worse, or then you can do the release of the contractures from the knee joint. Therefore, you must know the extent of contracture and the type of deformity and the age of the patient to know what and how to correct these deformity. And the ambulatory status of the patient, whether it is a wheelchair bound or he can do supported walk with the crutches, and the posture, how he doing. If he is in a hand knee gait, you need to support to prevent the recurvatum deformity and give the muscle transplants or the tendon transplants to get relief from and to restore from the hand knee position to a normal knee joint. But sometimes there may be a shortening, and we have already explained how do this shortening occur. Because of flaccidity, there is a lack of stimulation on the bone, so there is a lack of the longitudinal and oppositional growth, and if it is unilateral, it produce a deformity we call limb length discrepancy. So for muscle charting, you all knows from the Medical Research Council grading, which is very popular. If there is a complete paralysis, then it is zero power. But if there is a flicker of movements, just you can see, you can feel the muscle is contracting, then it is grade one. But if the joint is moved by the muscle with the gravity eliminated, if gravity is eliminated and muscle can move the joint, so it is power two. But when they're against the gravity, he can lift the foot up without the cordyceps paralysis against the gravity, but not against the resistance, then it is grade three. But grade four is when he can lift or he can move the joint against the resistance as well as against the gravity. So here is the addition of the resistance. You give just hold the leg and ask the patient to lift the leg and move the knee joint. If he can do against the gravity, then it is three. But if he has also the gravity and the resistance, then it is power four. But if he is a normal power, absolutely without any weakness, we call is a grade five power. So these are the very detailed examinations as well, clinical examination of musculoskeletal system. We don't need to do all these tests. In the hip joint, usually we do Ober test and the Thomas test. In the knee joint, for the instability of knee, we can see, and the valgus stress test. In foot and ankle, we do for the muscle examination, the power of the muscles and the deformity we want to see. So some details of these tests I will discuss with you. Most detailed discussion I already had, that was in the cerebral palsy clinical assessment. This is available in the slide share in my name and also my YouTube. This video and the slide both are available on the net. But I will little bit discuss about these very important tests which really related than poliomyelitis instead of cerebral palsy in small next few slides. So here is the gluteal abduction lurch, which we call a Trendelenburg test. Here there are three elements to produce this Trendelenburg test. One is the power when abductors are weak, but if when there is a fulcrum problem, we call a fracture of the neck of the femur, then there is an acetabulo-femoral articulation problems over the fulcrum, then it also produce a gluteal or the Trendelenburg test. And if severe lever arm is defective, or the length of the neck, or there is a fracture here, are then it produce again a positive temporal test. And we have given the details in the previous lecture of cerebral palsy. Here is the Thomas test, which we need to know, and obscure contractures at the hip joints, particularly, which cause the lifting of the spine, a curvature of the spine. So we do very common tests. We know, you know very well how to stabilize the hip joint and see the contracture of hip joint. And here it shows how this test is being performed by keeping the hand underneath with the flat top and the contractures and the modified contracture. If there is a contracture of knee joint, you must bring the patient at the edge and do the Thomas test again. So this is the Thomas test to know the obscure contractures at the hip joint would produce a curvature or the hyperlordosis deformity. Then sometimes we would like to know whether it is only hip muscle which causes the contractures or iliotibial bend which causes the flexure, or there is a tightness in the iliosop. It is said when the contralateral hip flexes without knee extension of the testing side, then it is the tight iliosas muscle on the test side. But if abducts with the Thomas test, then it is the tight tensor fasciae later. If he knee extension occur on the same side of the test, then it is the tightness of the rectus femoris as well. But if hip abduct or rotate laterally, externally, while doing the Thomas test, then we say there may be a tightness of the biceps femoris. So these are the additional judgments, tightness to differentiate the hip contracture, whether it is postural with the capsular or the arthritic knee, or it may be only tightness of the psoas or addition of the rectus femoris or tensor fasciae later. So here is the very important test, Ober test, we commonly ask you in the examinations. And this Ober test again give the differentiation or inference regarding the contractures of iliotibial bend. And iliotibial bend, I already explained, start from the hip joint to the knee joint. So it crosses over the two joints. It produces a contracture at the hip joint. It can produce a contracture in knee joint, which can be tested with the Ober joint test. Here we flex the knee joint up to 90 degree and extend while stabilizing the hip with the flexion of this contralateral hip. And we do this test by 90 degree flexion and abduction, and then leave the knee joint free. If it touches to the other side, it means there is a no contracture. But if it stays here in the abduction position, it means there is a contracture of iliotibial bend at the hip joint. But sometimes we also assess with the modified Ober test by keeping this knee abductant, external rotation, and extending the knee. And when you extend the knee, if it touches to the other leg, it means normal. If it does not touch to the other leg, it means there is a iliotibial bend contracture, which is producing a contracture at the hip joint, at the knee joint as well. So this is very important test, and modified Ober test. Then we also do the Yount test, which is again a contracture of the fascia lata, iliotibial bend, the muscle tensor fascia lata. In the supine position, if the leg is abducted, extended at the knee joint, it abducts. When it abducts, it indicates there is a contracture at the hip joint. So this was the neutral position when patient was lying. It may produce, it's just obvious issue, there is a flexion contracture at the hip joint and at the knee joint. But when you extend this limb, definitely it goes out of the central line to laterally. It means it relaxes the legs, abductors, and contracture is because of the abductors, that is because of the tensor fascia lata. So this is called Yount Ober test, and surgery is again Yount surgery in this particular case to release the iliotibial bend. Then again, very important test I am not covering the cerebral palsy, and over the testing of the muscles or tibialis anterior in the hang position and on the bed. In the hang position, you must give the markings where is the tibialis anterior and where is the extensor hallucis muscle. They both goes here, and sometimes you get confused. The overactivity of extensor hallucis longus
is seen as a tibialis anterior. So you have to differentiate whether it is tibialis anterior or the extensor hallucis longus. So here is two marking I have given. You feel the tibialis anterior and then ask patient to pull up to more the dorsiflexion position and also in the varus position. So when the muscle contract, it becomes very prominent tendon of the tibialis anterior. Here is the again an hanging type and the on the bed, the checking the tibialis posterior. Again, you have to feel the tendon of the tibialis posterior and give the resistance against the mobility of that. You ask the patient to adduct the forefoot, and this may also produce the plantar flexion. But when it adducts, you have to feel the tibialis posterior by itself. Then there are peroneal tests again in hanging on the bed position. You have to feel where is the peronei, feel the peronei, and ask the patient to externally rotate or abduct the foot, like in this to give the abducts, and you give the resistance to abduction. The tibia, this peronei become more prominent. When they become more prominent and they can resist against the resistance, it means tibialis posterior, this is peronei or Iskander, and the grading, already you know how to do grade this. So these are the three tests for tibialis anterior, tibialis posterior, and peronei, very important tests, particularly in peromyelitis. And we do, and this also provides us when there is a tibialis anterior paralysis, how we can substitute. So you have to test the all three groups of muscles so that you can plan your surgery easily. So other tests is that you know very well, leg length inequality. If there is a true contracture, true shortness, you do the block test and see how much centimeter it is to eradicate the pelvic obliquity. If pelvic obliquity become normal with raising of the shoe or block, then we call it as a true deformity. Then as apparent deformity, here there seems to be equal length, but pelvis is tilted because there is a contracture of abduction on this side. So test should be done by keeping both legs in the same position and then measure. And there is a measurement difference, then you call is a true difference in the measurement. Then you also do the branch triangle measurements. If the vertical limb of branch triangle is disturbed or shorter, you say there is a problem in the above the trochanter. So branches, you know very well, and you can also see when these slides will be presented in slide share. Then to detect the ambulatory status, we need to carry all these tests, which I have already explained in the gait and analysis of the gait lecture. And this is the slide share detail and the YouTube. It is also available on YouTube. You can see the details of these observational gait and gait analysis laboratory, what type of gait he is doing, then abductor lurch, extensor lurch, handy gait, calcaneus deformity, foot drop and short limb. All these has been explained very detailed in the gait disorder analysis lecture 2 months back I have delivered, and you can see through the slide share and the YouTube as well. Then what are the prognostic factors which produce, which can assess whether what will be the result of the treatment? So severity of initial paralysis, diffuseness of regional distribution. If only foot is involved, or foot and knee is involved, or foot and hip is involved, that has also very important factor to while planning the surgery. Then patient expectation. Always they ask, will cheap ho jayega? If he become normal, there's other children? No. Then they also, this expectation, if you must explain in the counseling and support they may need and in the post-operative care and the long term. Then resource availability as well. These are the three, four important factors in the planning, treatment, and getting the prognosis, better prognosis. It is said if total paralysis percent beyond the second month of the age, more than 2 months, the recovery is unlikely. If initial paralysis is partial, prognosis is better. In general, it says if there is extensor paralysis in the first days of illness, the severity or illness, the more disability may be the ultimate outcome. So what are the options for reconstructive surgery? Now we will discuss the last part of this lecture, the principles of management. Only discuss, not discuss the regional management, but the principles. So reconstructive surgery options, we have the release of contracture, which can be done by the fasciotomy, other capsules like Suter's fasciotomy, or iliotibial bend, which we call the extendler release by cutting 1 centimeter of the iliotibial bend above the knee joint, and the capsulotomy, posterior capsulotomy of the knee joint. Then re-establishment of power, which can be done with the tendon transfer of the peroni to the tibialis anterior deficit, or muscle transposition, which we do rectus abdominis, or the abdominal obliques to replace the abductor paralysis in the hip joint. But sometimes you find a flail joints of the knee joint or the ankle joint. Here, you often do a tenodesis or reconstruct artificial ligaments to give the stability to the flail joints. And sometimes you correct the deformities with the osteotomies, with the Lizarov method, or sometimes in the ankle and foot, you do the arthrodesis, but not at the knee joint. In very, very, very rare cases, you can do the arthrodesis of knee joint. Otherwise, shoulder arthrodesis is very common option. This. So third, fourth, fifth option is limb lengthening. In unilateral lerasis, there is significant more than 3 or 5 centimeter deficit or limb length disparity. You do the limb lengthening by Lizarov technique, and you also simultaneously release the contracture. But in adults, in the lab, when there is a pain in the knee joint or a hip joint, you sometimes also do the replacement surgery, which is also indicated very few cases. And I will discuss the what is the prognosis of joint replacement in polio surgery. The polio pelvic obliquity is very important. It may be a postural, or it may be because of a scoliosis. Then you also need a correction of the pelvic ability by the spinal deformity correction as well. So now, what are the principles of tendon transfer? There are 10 principles of the tendon transfer. One is this: the transferred muscle must be stronger enough to support the weak muscle. Second, when you transport the tendon, you must take care of the neurovascular bundle. If you disturb the neurovascular bundle of the tendon, particularly by tibialis posterior transfer to tibialis anterior or the peroni transfer to tibialis anterior, this may got damaged, then you will not find a good results. Then transfer tendon should be attached securely, very important, with tension near the insertion of the paralyzed muscle. And you must ensure the security you have given or the anchoring you have given, it may hold the part in optimal position. The tendon should be rooted in direct line, not angular type of transfers, particularly when you are doing the semitendinosus for the patella, you must give it a direct line of transfers. And there should not be going through a pulley system. You construct a pulley like in the hand. Sometimes in the paralysis, you do the pulley methods. So it should be a direct line. It should not be through a pulley. And transfer tendon loses power 1 grade. Therefore, a transfer muscle should have minimum 4 or 5 power. And the recipient also should have a power 2. When you do a semitendinous transfer, a bicep transfer through the quadricep, you must ensure the quadricep must have a power 2, because they lose. If you transfer a 4 power, then it will be 3 grade power in the knee joint in the transferred tendon. Therefore, it must be ensured that it should have a power 4 or 5, and recipient muscle must also have a flicker in the test. Then the sixth principle, transfer of the agonist muscles is very important, and preferably it should be agonist. Like in tibialis anterior, you must better to transfer the peroni as compared to agonist, like the tibialis posterior is agonist to the tibialis anterior. It loses more than 2 power when antagonist muscle is transferred. And also similar range of exertion should have that the tendon you are transferring. You also need to preserve the paratenon, because you have to give the smoothness with the movement of the tendon, and there should not be adhesion development if you preserve the paratenon. Then it should not be passed through the fascia or intraosseous membrane. If you can avoid, you do it, and because of adhesions. And preferably tendon sheath, pass through the tendon sheath through the deep fascia, but sometimes not really to the subcutaneous plane. And very important thing is you must correct the contracture and the deformities before tendon transfer. If there is a contracture, even if you transfer the tendon, it will not release the contracture. It will not deformity correct the deformity as already have. So if a muscle transposition is being done in the file substitute of the paralysis, particularly like transposition of the muscles in upper limb particularly, and it is not a popular procedure, then tendon transfer, because of difficulty finding a normal muscles to transplant, and there is a comorbid side of comorbidity at the site of the from the transfer position, then there is a technical difficulties also to preserve its neurovascular bundle, and also it is mostly done by microvascular surgeons to the free Phillips, particularly free muscle transposition, you need a microvascular surgeon as well. So stabilization of the joint is usually done with the tenodesis or producing a new artificial check ligaments. Objective again is to restrict the range of motion and to eliminate the abnormal motion at the joint, filial joint, to treat the flail joint. Here is complications that it may relax over time, and the artificial ligaments are tendons which you have developed in long time, they may stretch again and recurrence of deformity may occur. This technique is particularly be helpful, particularly in immature patients. Then in the mature patients, in the adults or near adolescent deformity, you can do the arthrodesis of the filial joints. Particularly we do in the shoulder and the foot, where we do the Lambert-Oddy procedure in association with the triple fian to restrict the multiple joint movements and give good strength to the foot by the tendon transfers as well, or the weak transfer already there, and the correction of the deformity. So we do the Lambert-Oddy procedure, simple Lambert-Oddy procedure, or sometimes we do the triple fian along with the Lambert-Oddy procedure in the poliomyelitis. Then the timing is very important. What should be done and when should be done? You should not do any treatment, surgical treatment, within 1.5 years of the paralytic attack. It should be done, particularly 2 years gap should be given, or 1.5 year gap should be given. Then transfer tendon can be done in skeletally immature patients. And this can be in the adolescent patient or teenage, over 9 or 10 years age, you can combine the tendon transfer along with the arthrodesis. This is particularly in the feet. So if you do extra articular arthrodesis, this is the age of extra arthrodesis. This is in the 10 to 3 below 8 years. And when usually triple arthrodesis, we do over 10 years of age, but complete arthrodesis in the flail, total flail ankle joint, we end in the shoulder joint, we do ankle or the fusion of the shoulder over 18 years age. Perioperative education and postoperative care is very important in the reconstructive surgery. When you train the patient to localize the muscle perioperatively, he can do a better exercises, which has to be continued in postoperative method, in the postoperative period. And muscle re-education may be delayed when tendon is transferred with arthrodesis until an adequate bony fusion occur. If early re-education you will start, this may produce a pseudoarthrosis in the fused joint. Then postoperative care is again a plasters or splints or the half splint or complete plasters during early postoperative phase must be given, and a bivalve cast or arthrosis to avoid the transfer tendon to get relaxation. So at least 6 weeks to 2 months must be given for the postoperative training and early starting the normal rehabilitative exercises in the reconstructive surgery. Limb lengthening is very common, and we do it mostly with the Elizarov method. And then when you do the Elizarov method, you can achieve the stability in the knee joint, at the hip, in the ankle joint, while lengthening the knee joint with the same apparatus. But since callus maturation is slow, post-polio residual paralysis patient tend to redevelop the contractures despite physiotherapy, bracing and joint fixation. So it needs a continuous exercise and physiotherapy and the sprints to maintain the normal joint which you have achieved and the joint and the bone which you have given the lengthening. And it is said in polomyelitis, the lengthening over the interlocked nail inside the bone is very beneficial as compared to simple lengthening procedure with the Lizurofe. Very rarely, if there is a pain in the knee joint, the people change the joints, knee joints, particularly when there is a good little bit stability is there. But over the time, this may also got early wear in the knee joints. Lizurofe technique is, there is certain risk is usually indicated when there is a significant risk of neurovascular injury by the tendon or muscle transposition, soft tissue injuries, or the shortening of the bone, in particular in the foot, then you use a Lizurofe technique to keep the height, size of the foot normal. But it has a certain complication as well. That is the pentrac problems, recurrence of the contracture, residual deformity, recurrence of deformity, which are preventable by the further splinting and the exercises. So again, aim of the Lizurofe technique is to achieve the comprehensive correction, to minimize the energy expenditure by walking and improving the gait, and discard the calipers. And we use this Lizurofe technique particularly in release the contracture, to correct the deformities, to fuse the stabilized joints, and simultaneous limb lengthening. So last part of the treatment is the chart. I usually take for last 15, 20 years, I was discussing with my trainees, every trainee for this chart. When you assess the limb deformities, deficits of the muscle, you must chart as per the area in this particularly a decision-making chart, which deformity is there in the hip joint, what are the deficits of the muscles around the hip joint or the knee joint, how you can substitute this muscle and which muscle you can substitute. And same is for the knee joint, and particularly very important, particularly ankle and foot deformity is equinovarus. Deficit is because of the peroneal weakness. Substitute is tibialis posterior or tibialis anterior transfer to the center. And what will be the result? You can write the remarks. So when you, by this assessment, deformity, deficit, and substitute, you can, and the diagnosis, whether it is recurvatum deformity at the knee joint, or there is a valgus deformity, ankle joint, and the, what is the demand of the patient? What is the age of the patient? What they demand? This also needs to be considered and the counsel. Once you have this, done these parameters, then decision for this is very important. Okay, which muscle has to be substituted for which deficit, and which contracture has released and deformity has been. This I will discuss in the next lecture in very detail with the patients. So little few words about the post-polio syndrome. Now in this era, particularly in our status, most of the patients comes to you, kedi mujhe weakness ho rahi hai, I am developed this weakness. When you take history, you can find there was a poliomyelitis. So it is called post-male polio syndrome. And I have also written an article on this in 1999. And definition is the development of new weaknesses or increased weakness in the previously affected muscles, which has been restored, or there was a minimum paralysis. But at 20 and 25 years after initial paralysis, the muscles get the weaknesses. And then the contrary to severe paralysis, polymerization, they may occur. Then neurosurgical, non-surgical treatment is again splints, orthoses, which also deformity corrections, and certain medical treatment to prevent and treat polio, post-polio syndrome. And surgical reconstruction, again, same, maybe a worsening scoliosis, deformity of the knee or foot, that you have to take care. And sometimes you can give the braces, but its complication rate is high in this particular cases. So this is around the 50, 45 minutes lecture. If I combine a lecture one and a lecture two, then your position will be this. You cannot, right? Therefore, I divided this lecture in the two. In last lecture, we will have a regional deformities, reconstructive surgery principles, what reconstructive surgery we will do, inshallah, on Friday, 9th April, and we will have a same experts. Now, these are the articles and the books I referred for this, preparing this lecture over 15 days. So now it is the faculty discussion. Over to the professor Suhail Rafi to continue and have a faculty discussion.
Sir, thank you very much for your very elaborative talk on the subject. And though we are seeing these post-polio residual deformities declining, but when we were learning and doing our residency, that was the very frequent pathology. So thank you very much for your elaborative talk, and you have given the basic pathophysiology, how the deformities are developed, and how to assess clinically, and how to do the preventive measures and making the decisions for correction of the deformities. So we have learned a lot, and I must congratulate Ziauddin Hospital, who has been arranging these CMEs continuously, and you are on board. And we are learning a lot, though we are sitting in Larkana or other thing, but we are connected and learning a lot. Thank you, sir.
Dr. Zameen, thank you very much, and for encouraging us. First of all, by Dr. Anish Bhatti, the polio is always a confusing sort of a subject, and he has elaborated it very clearly, and hopefully we will learn more in the lecture too. I wish the Pakistan will become a polio-free country, and hopefully our juniors will not see the post-polio deformity cases. But till then, this is a very important lecture, and I think everybody should know the tendons and the transfers and the deformities, which Dr. Anish Bhatti is the person to learn from. Sir, over back to you, sir. Over back to Atta.
What are the questions?
Sir, so, there is only a single question up till yet, which states that what is the best option in knee flexion contracture more than 40 degrees at adolescence and adult?
Thank you very much to the experts. Actually, for the knee contracture, regional contractures of the knee, foot, ankle, and hip, and the shoulder, and the elbow, and the wrist, I will discuss in the detail how these contractures are developing and how to manage these complications will be in the second lecture. So it is better to have a detailed discussion in the second lecture on this, and just waiting for the 1 week. On the Friday, same experts we will have, and we will do the surgery and what surgeries we can do, how to release the contracture, what are the methods of the contractures. But if you say the contractures release in early stage, here you should not pull through the foot, but you should pull the knee, below knee, tibia anteriorly, and pushing the femur posteriorly. If you pull to release the contracture for the physiotherapy, if you from the foot, it will increase the recurvatum as compared. Therefore, it is better to have a treatment through near to the knee joint. And if you even need to do the skeletal traction management, you also have to place two pins, one in upper tibia and other in lower tibia, to prevent the subluxation of knee joint. So release of contracture by physiotherapy, by the traction method, should be proper by pulling or managing the knee joint near to the joint. So we will take the surgical details in the next lecture, inshallah, after 1 week. I have already prepared the lecture. We will do it.
Okay, so Dr. Abdul Rahman has been asking regarding any advice on short book or a good book on polio. So I think Dr. Anishuddin Bhatti has already mentioned the references from which he took these details from.
So, Rahman, this lecture by the Professor Benjamin Joseph is the very authority in the pediatric orthopedic surgery. He has written a very nice article on the reviewing the concept, polyomyelitis revisiting in Journal of Pediatric Orthopedics, Children Orthopedic in 2015. Others, I have given the three publications on this. One is the polio deformities, rehabilitation movement, and the polio syndrome, which were published in 99 and 98. Taj Dion has also given very good concepts of the management in the poliomyelitis. But new of the Campbell's, which you are using, it has not given you the treatment. But I, which I have used, the Campbell was the 9th and 10th edition. This gives a very good concept of the surgical management. You also can have a good lectures from where some text I have taken was the lecture of the Krishna Sai and the slide share. But most important lecture, I would say, important publication is Bonjan Joseph. You can copy this and the insert in the Google. You will get this literature very publication very easily and very elaborative. He has explained the methods and the review on the poliomyelitis. Benjamin Joseph.
I would like to thank Professor Bhatti for very informative and comprehensive lecture on the pathogenesis and the assessment of post polio paralysis and patient with deformities. As you know, this post polio paralysis patients we are seeing these days, they are very few number of cases, and they usually present in the lower limbs. And as he has mentioned, that more than 90% involvement in the lower limbs. And the treatment is usually a multidisciplinary approach required, in which in the early stage, as the convalescent stage, if we provide good orthotics and good physio, we can prevent the contracture formation in the lower limbs especially. But as he has mentioned, that in 30% cases, the residual paralysis is there, and the orthopedic surgeon has to treat these 30% of the post-polio paralysis patients. And the most commonly involved muscle, as Professor has mentioned, is the quadriceps muscles. So one should know the treatment of the most common deformities in post-polio. When the quadriceps is paralyzed, patient presents with hand-to-knee gait. So the decision-making is basically based on the age of the patient, the magnitude of the deformity, and the available muscles available for the transfers in order to restore the balance of the limbs. So one should have a good knowledge about the remaining available muscles to be transferred, and we should follow the basic principles of the tendon transfer in order to have a good post-op outcome. And in management of the post-polio deformities, especially in the lower limbs, there's definitely a role of Elisdorf apparatus because it gives advantages. At the same time, we can correct the deformity, the contracture release, as well as we can address the limb rent discrepancy of the patients, especially in cases of the paralytic hips or having significant shortening in the lower limbs. We can have a pelvic support osteotomy in order to have a good lever arm of the muscles, abductor muscles, and at the same time, we can lengthen the limb, improve the gait of the patient. So that's all. And once again, thank you, sir, for giving me the opportunity to speak to you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Farid. Thank you very much, Dr. Zamir Sumro. Your lecture has been great, and thank you for giving us your input. So, yes, thank you, faculty, including Dr. Imtiaz, Dr. Suhail Rafi, Dr. Nadeem Baloch, Dr. Idris Shah, and Dr. Shehbaz Khan, new addition. Thank you very much, sirs. I think this has been a great talk, Dr. Bhatti. Thank you very much. As being a resident, a lot of things have been clarified in great depth. And inshallah, we are looking forward to the next lecture. So with this, we conclude our session today. Thank you, all the attendees, for joining. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, dear.